Today our title is going to be on the power of praise and worship. The power of praise and worship. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's what we just felt today, right? Amen. We have felt the Holy Spirit moving amongst his people. And God, and that's why I say God is so good. He's so faithful because he always gives to us his word. In every time, every step, every season of our lives, he is always faithful to give to us what we need. And so the power of praise and worship. Before we go on, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you so much with our hearts agreeing together to you, O God, as we worship you and glorify and magnify your holy name, Lord. We thank you so much, Lord Father, for being here. You are never too far away from your people, O God. You are always near, reminding us all the time, Lord. You are always knocking at our door, Lord Father God, instructing us, O Lord, the way and the direction to go in serving you, O Lord Jesus. And so we thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the people that are able to be here today, Lord God. We thank you for them, O Lord, and we thank you for everyone that has put in a good work, Lord, the multimedia, the praise and worship team, and everyone, O God, who are working together, Lord, as a family of believers in you, God, in making this happen for you, O Lord, in saving lives and saving souls for your kingdom, O God. Lord, so we ask, O Father, for your Holy Spirit to move in our hearts today, to prepare our minds and our hearts and our thoughts, Lord, as we receive your word for us this morning. Lord, may your Holy Spirit, O Father, the power and the anointing of your Holy Spirit speak to your people, O God. Hide me behind your face, Lord Jesus Christ, and may you take away any nervousness, any fear, any doubt, any worry, Lord Father God, that I may have, Lord, but that your confidence and your love will take over, Lord. Let your people hear you, O God, and speak, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Lord Jesus, amen and amen. The power of praise and worship. What an exciting title. I mean, I wasn't even sure myself, like, this was the title God had given me. But I'm just so blessed right now to have the privilege and the honor to share to you guys about this message. Praise and worship has a very prominent place in the Old Testament and the New Testament. But how does praise and worship affect our daily lives? How can we unlock its power? What if we don't feel like praising God? Brothers and sisters, this message in God will hopefully bring us to a conclusion of the importance of praise and worship. So today, church, our reading is taken from Acts 16, verse 23 to 26. Acts 16, verse 23 to 26. We're not going to read the whole chapter. There's a lot going on in that chapter, but I just wanted to point out this specific event in that chapter. Because our title is based on verse 25 and 26. So let us read. It says, after they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in an inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prisons were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Amen. The context of this chapter is all about proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the missionary work of Paul and his companions to go from town to town, except in the province of Asia, because the Holy Spirit wouldn't let them. And so right throughout the whole chapter, at the end of this event, which we have just read about, the jailer who was ordered by the Roman authorities to put Paul and Silas in prison came to believe and received the gospel of Jesus Christ. And in verse 34 there it says, we are told that the jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God, he and his household. And so Paul and Silas were finally released from prison and carried on their ministry until they left Philippi. They encouraged the brothers there and saved souls for God. And so the verses we just read about from 23 to 26, this all started from the unjust arrest of Paul and Silas, because they had cast a spirit of divination out of a girl. So she was a fortune teller. And the people there, the men there, were making money out of her. And so when Paul cast the spirit out of that girl, they were angry. They were furious at Paul for doing that. And so they went to the authorities, and the local authorities ordered to have Paul and Silas to be beaten up and put them into jail. And so beside the trauma of the severe beating, they were fastened in stocks, which I'm sure it clamped them from their legs in an immobile position, causing cramps and loss of circulation. The atmosphere there was depressing. It was not good. It was not a very good, you know, atmosphere that you would want to be in. Because according to the standards of that day, a prison was more like a dungeon. You know, it was a resemblance of a dungeon, like it's just so dark. It was dark, it was damp, it was stench-ridden, with no facility for waste or comforts of any kind. And yet, in spite of the throbbing pain in their bodies and the disheartening atmosphere, at midnight, Paul and Silas were heard praying and singing praises to God. What a strange sound this may have been for the other prisoners, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure all they heard, you know, before Paul and Silas got in there was just the beating and the cursing of the other prisoners, right? But as Paul and Silas prayed and sung hymns to God, suddenly there was an earthquake that shook the prison. The doors flung open, and amazingly, the bonds of Paul and Silas and everyone, the prisoners that was listening in, were released. And so the question then comes to mind, what caused this mighty discharge of power? What caused this mighty discharge of power? In verse 25, it says, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. And that brings me to our first point for today. Praise and worship elevates us into God's presence and power. Praise and worship elevates us into God's presence and power. Paul and Silas were helpless in their circumstances physically, but they knew the secret of how to lift their hearts above their troubles and enter into God's presence and power. Paul and Silas, through their mouths, praised and worshiped God. Their hearts were raised into a joyous presence and peace of God, and provided God a channel for his power to operate in their circumstances. What a magnificent sight, isn't it? What a magnificent sight to feel and to hear from the faith of these two brave men of God. Amen. In Psalms 22, verse 3 of the King James Version Bible, it says that God inhabits in the praises of his people. In other words, God dwells in the atmosphere of his praise. His holy presence lingers on like the smell of a sweet perfume in your bedrooms, in your cars, in your homes, and in your lives. His holy presence will never wear out like any new shoes that you go and buy or a new dress that has just gone out of fashion, you know, each year, right? No, but rather, his presence keeps us alive and well to push through our problems and trials of life. His presence will never cease when his people are gathered in worship and in prayer, personally and corporately. This corresponds with Jesus' teaching in Matthew 18, verse 20, where he says, "For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I with them." A gathering in his name means that Jesus must be the focus, the center of the assemblage. He must be the one preached about and sung about, the one that is praised and worshipped, therefore. Christ's presence, along with his virtue and anointing, is manifested in this type of gathering. This means that praise is more than a reaction of coming into his presence. Praise to God is a vehicle of our faith which takes us into his presence and power. Praise and worship is the gate pass which allows us to enter the sacredness of his glory. We praise and worship him first and foremost, above anything else, because we believe in his great love for us on the cross. Amen. We praise and worship him for who he is, for the indescribable moments he has come through for us. Time and time again, he has never failed us. And I can testify of this myself, because God has come through for me a million times, a million times. For he has put up with me so many times, and he has delivered me from my wrongs. God has done so many wonderful things to me and my family. And I'm not just talking about the material blessings, but I'm talking more about the spiritual blessings of God. He has created in me a new person. He's given me a new heart to love and to desire him more and more each day. And that's why I'm able to stand here today. He gives me strength. And mostly I can see that, and I can do all of that because I know that he forgives me. I'm able because he is a loving father. He is a forgiving father. I'm forgiven, and so are you. Amen. Just as many of you have your own story to testify of God's faithfulness, we can all stand with Paul and Silas in moments like that and be bold to give praise and worship to God, regardless of our circumstances. The psalmist writes in Psalms 100 verse 4, it says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name." Let us give back to God the praise and honor of our mouths and our hearts individually and corporately. God loves to take his throne and just indulge in the moments when his people come to worship and praise him. The power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit usually becomes evident subsequent to a time of worship and praise. Some think that worship is a response after the Holy Spirit moves upon them. But you see, it's the total opposite. God's presence responds when we ourselves move upon him. We got to believe in who we are praising and worshiping. We got to understand why we praise and worship. We got to fully be engaged with all our hearts and emotions to God when we praise and worship his holy name. Exalting Jesus Christ through praise and worship invokes the Lord's presence and power to flow in our midst. Amen. So what is praise? Praise means to commend, to applaud or magnify. For the Christian, praise to God is an expression of worship, lifting up and glorifying the Lord. It is an expression of humbling ourselves and centering our attention upon the Lord with heartfelt expressions of love, adoration, and thanksgiving. High praises bring our spirit into a pinnacle of fellowship and intimacy between ourselves and God. It magnifies our awareness of our spiritual union with the Most High God. Praise transports us into the realm of the supernatural and into the power of God. Hallelujah. There are many actions involved with praise of God. We've got the verbal expressions of adoration and thanksgiving. We are singing, we are playing instruments, we are shouting, we are dancing, we are lifting or clapping our hands. But true praise is not merely going through these motions. Jesus spoke about the hypocrisy of the Pharisees, whose worship was only an outward show and not from the heart. He says there in Matthew 15, verse 8, "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." Genuine praise to God is a matter of humility and sincere devotion to the Lord from within. Unpretentious praise and worship pleases the Lord. He delights in the love and the devotion of his children. According to the scriptures, the various expressions of praise bring blessing to the Lord. He eagerly awaits the fragrance of our affections, desiring to manifest his sweet presence and power in our midst. In John 4, verse 23 to 24, it says, "The true worshipers should worship the Father in the spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth." These are the two things that you ought to be aware about when you praise and worship God. First is the spirit. Second is truth. You must recognize and acknowledge the Holy Spirit that is dwelling in you, the Spirit of God that reveals to you the truth of who and what he is. This very same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead enables us to act, to sing, to talk, to walk, to stand when we are in the presence of God. Amen. You see, if your own selfish heart does not want to work with the Spirit of God, we will surely lack in our praise and worship of God. When our own selfish heart does not want to work with the Spirit of God, we will surely lack in our praise of God. And when we lack in our praise and worship of God, there is no room for growth and change in our lives and in our situation and in this church. God loves and desires to hear and listen to the sound of his people calling and shouting and singing out his name. Amen. And our second point, praise and worship to God is a lifestyle for a Christian. Praise and worship to God is a lifestyle for a Christian. As for Paul and Silas, before they were thrown into jail, praise and worship was already part of their everyday life. So it didn't matter where they were or how uncomfortable they may have been with the stocks on their feet. Praising and worshiping God was something that they were well known for. And it came naturally to them. because Jesus is the center and the lifestyle of their faith. Amen. You know, my children usually, they would often gather around the television and they like to watch their favorite TV show, and they would gather around the TV and just sit there quietly. And well, sometimes, you know, they're not always quiet, they're very noisy. But I would be in the kitchen, you know, I would be in the kitchen cooking. And but because I've got my eye on them and I can see them, you know, with what they're doing. And so there was one day where they were sitting around the television and there was just silence. Like no one was talking, it was just the TV that was on. And out of the blue, my oldest son, Quentin, he just burst out singing this praise and worship song, and I'm like out of the blue, and everyone was just watching TV, and then, you know, and he would sing, Spirit lead me where my trust is without borders, let me walk upon the waters. And as I listened on, like, you know, I was like, wow, that sounds really good, because he is a good singer, like, you know, you must hear him, he's very good. But he, you know, he doesn't admit it because he, you know, he's a very shy boy. And so, you know, as I listened on and I noticed, you know, four of them, the other four that were watching TV, they completely ignored the television and joined in with him. You know, they joined in and I could hear them singing. And I'm like, wow, that is such a ridiculous, amazing sound of praise and worship that came from them. You know, I was like, oh my gosh, that's a band right there, Lord. Like, that's a band right there. I want to make a band, you know. I just stood there and I listened and they continued singing. You know, wherever you will call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. No, it didn't sound like that, because I'm sure, you know, it didn't sound like that. But, you know, so, you know, as a parent, you know, you just want to grab your phone and, you know, take, you know, a picture of that moment. It's like, oh my gosh, I got to put this on Facebook. No. But, you know, I'm sure parents, right, you like to take moments, you know, those precious moments of your children, because that's them growing, right? And so, but knowing me, you know, my phone is always out of reach whenever I'm in the kitchen. And so anyway, I was like, oh, forget it. You know, I'm just going to stand here. And so I just stood there and, you know, and just pretended that, you know, I wasn't listening to them, but really I was, you know, I was just really listening to them singing. And I was just embracing them, you know, admiring, you know, their faith, admiring that moment where they were praising and worshiping God. It was already part of their lifestyle. You know, and how amazing it is when you hear your children praise and worship God, right? It is so amazing. It makes you feel like you are doing something right, right? Parents, do you agree? Like, it makes you feel like you are doing the right thing. You're saying, Lord, I know that this is you, and I thank you for that, because this is my prayer every day. My prayer every day is for you to guide my children, that they will not go, that they will not go following this world, but they will follow you. Amen. And so it's amazing. And so, you know, I do encourage you, you know, maybe next time I'll try and, you know, keep my phone in my pockets all the time so I can take moments like that of my children. But anyway, but you see, church, all too often, praise to God is something that many people leave at church. It is an event that happens only when they come together with other Christians. However, praise should be a part of a believer's lifestyle, intermingled as part of their daily prayer life. At work, in the car, at home, in bed, or just anywhere. Praise to the Lord brings the refreshing of the Lord's presence along with his power and anointing. In Psalms 34 verse 1, it says that I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. And that brings us to our third point. Praise and worship to God defeats the enemy. Praise and worship to God defeats the enemy. Verse 26, suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prisons were shaken. At once all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Praise and worship is an expression of faith and a declaration of victory. Hallelujah. Imagine an Olympic runner, right? They are running with all their might and with all their strength, you know, not looking to, you know, to anywhere else but just forward. And they are running, running so hard, wanting to win that race and wanting to get to that finish line. And as they get to the finish line, what do? They stretch out their arms. And they're like, yes, oh, victory is mine. I just won, yes. You know, the first place, you know, runner, they lift up their hands, right? But what does that say to us? You know, for us Christians, we have to understand that by lifting our hands, when we praise and worship, we are declaring the victory that has been won for us by Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, on that cross. Victory over our difficulties of life and victory over the enemy and his schemes. Jesus defeated the enemy when he overcame the beating and death on that cross when he resurrected into heaven after 3 days. And that's why we are celebrating next Sunday. Amen. Another illustration would be a police officer. He catches a thief. And he pulls out his gun and he says, freeze, don't move, right? That's in a movie, by the way. I just yeah. He says, freeze, don't move. But what do you think this thief is going to do? He's going to put his hands right up, right? His hands are going straight into the air. Why? Because it's sending a message to the police officer that I surrender. I surrender. But he's not going to try and move because try and run because, you know, he's going to get shot. You know, he won't run because he will get shot. But you see, church, the lifting of our hands also signifies ourselves surrendered to God and his will. We are declaring to God that we are weak, that we are broken, we are lost, that we are here to surrender every broken pieces of our lives to him. That he is our only helper, our comforter in troubled times, our healer in all our sickness, our way maker and miracle worker, our promise keeper, and our only provider. Hallelujah. It declares that we believe God is with us and is in control of the outcome of all our circumstances. Praise is a sacrifice, something that we offer to God sacrificially, not just because we feel like it, but because we believe in him and wish to please him. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. That's in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. Since praise manifests God's presence, we also realize that praise withstands the presence of the enemy. An atmosphere which is filled with sincere worship and praise to God by humble and contrite hearts is sickening to the devil. He fears the power of the name of Jesus and flees from the Lord's habitation in praise. Notice the intensity of, do you notice the intensity of this place when the Holy Spirit moves in this place? It's magnificent, isn't it? I love it. Like, I just love it. It's so amazing. There's no words for it that you can describe it. It's just, it's out of this world, and that's who God is. But you see, church, I tell you, when we praise and worship the Lord with our mouths open and hearts agreeing together towards Him, God truly moves and shows His manifestation presence in the gathering of His people. It is that strong for a person to contain it, because it sets you feeling happy and excited. Yes, yes, let's go, Lord. That's me. It sets you feeling breathless, like you have been running for a 40-kilometer marathon. It really does. And it sets you at a heartbeat that is so abnormal. That is so abnormal, you know, to feel. Glory, hallelujah. What a powerful God we serve, amen. There's a story in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. When the children of Judah and Jerusalem found themselves outnumbered by the hostile armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, and King Jehoshaphat and all the people sought the Lord for his help, and the people assured, and the Lord assured the people that that this would be his battle, and he told them to go out against him, and he would do the fighting for them. So the children of Judah and Jerusalem went out and obeyed God's instructions. And knowing that God manifests his power through praise, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness. And so on they went ahead of the army, declaring, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever." And so the scripture says there in verse 22, as they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. Amen. And so we also know of King David's beautiful sight of dancing. I love David. Like, I adore him so much. Jesus more than him, of course, you know. But I just love David. Like, he's everything. You know, I don't know. No, I'm joking. I'm joking. I adore his faith. That's the right word. I adore his faith, you know, in God. But, you know, and so we know that story of King David, you know, dancing before the Lord, giving praise and worship to God, when he and the Israelites brought the Ark of the Lord into the city of Jerusalem, right, from Baal. And so, and that's in 2 Samuel chapter 6. And so in verse 14 and 15 there it says, and David danced before the Lord with all his might, wearing a priestly garment. So David and all the people of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of ram's horns. But I just want us to continue on to verse 16. There it says, but as the Ark of the Lord entered the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked down from her window. When she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she was filled with contempt for him. I just want us to look at this, because I love the response of David to Michal here in verse 20 to 22 of that same chapter, because I believe it is very relevant to our topic for us today. So in verse 20 there it says, when David returned home to bless his own family, Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him. She said in disgust, how distinguished the king of Israel looked today, shamelessly exposing himself to the servant girls like any vulgar person might do. And David retorted to Michal, I was dancing before the Lord, who chose me above your father and all his family. He appointed me as the leader of Israel, the people of the Lord. So I celebrate before the Lord. Yes, and I am willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. But those servant girls you mentioned will indeed think that I am distinguished. Amen. Brothers and sisters, We have to understand that the devil is watching our every move. And the moment we decide to not worship and praise God, he makes his way through and robs you of your joy. Killing and manipulating as many souls as he can get his hands on from walking in the light and the truth of God. The world will always look at us with contempt because of our faith in God. Amen? Unbelievers will watch on as you give praise and worship to God the Father for who he is and what he has done for you personally. But they will never understand the joy of it until they themselves come to know and receive God as their Lord and Savior. For them to experience themselves what we encounter when we are in the presence of God. Amen. When God's people begin to praise his name, the enemy is defeated. When Paul and Silas gave praise and worship to God as an instance of their faith, their chains came loose together with the prisoners that were listening in. Deliverance was brought forth and victory was won in favor of Paul and Silas. God's grace and mercy and power is extended and open to anyone who listens to his truth and receives it with sincerity in their hearts. So, church, are we willing to give God the praise and worship that he deserves always? Are we willing? Are we really willing? Amen. Riso Church, brothers and sisters, I challenge you today to become a person of praise and worship and declare it to the world and to the enemy. As David would say, yes, and I am willing to look even more foolish than this, even to be humiliated in my own eyes. So say to yourselves, and I want us to all say this, say to yourselves, I will sing, I will dance, I will lift my hands, and I will clap with my heart in awe of his glorious love. Come on, church. I mean, that's not a declaration. If you're declaring to God, you've got to declare it with all your heart. Come on. Let's do it again. I will sing. I will dance. I will lift my hands. And I will clap with my heart in awe of his glorious love. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So we come together and we praise God for that. We worship him because he is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let us experience the release of the power of God and adore him with every fiber in our being. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you so much, oh God.